Something at the beginning.
So today we're going to have a guest lecturer. Gaddy Getz is the director of bioinformatics at MGH and also the director of cancer genome atlas at the Broad Institute. He's also a professor of pathology at Harvard Medical School. He is the world expert in tumor genome analysis. And welcome, Gaddy.
Thank you, Shirley, for the invitation. It's great to present in this course. And I know this is a remote teaching, so please feel free to ask questions when you need to ask questions. So first of all, a bit of an ad. I'm looking for master's, PhD students and postdocs. So if you're interested, please send me an email. So cancer is a disease of the genome and the epigenome. We all start from a fertilized egg with potential germline risk alleles for developing cancer. Then as cells divide, they accumulate DNA damage. A lot of the damage is repaired by repair mechanisms, but some of the damage is not repaired and they stay as mutations in the genome. Most of the mutations don't do anything and or maybe even are slightly deleterious to the cells, but some mutations could increase the fitness of the cells and the cells start to either grow faster or die slower and accumulate and creating a clone. These clones are not yet cancer, they are pre-cancer, and they continue to grow, and at some point, additional driver event could happen, and that could eventually transform into cancer. At some point, there could be that the immune system identifies the clone and starts to attack it, and there could be driver events that evade the immune response. So all these mutations that increase the fitness of the cells, we call them drivers, and all the other mutations that are happening and don't increase the fitness of cells, we call them passengers. Eventually, when cancer is diagnosed, the cells are highly rearranged with many mutations, could be between 0.1 to 100 mutations per megabase of the genome, and could be thousands of structural variations, but only roughly a handful of them are actually drivers that gave fitness advantage to the cells. Here's the last clonal driver, meaning it's all the cancer cells are descendant of this cell, and they therefore contain all the driver and passenger events that happened all the way back all to the fertilized egg. And here are subclonal drivers. So for example, this set of cells are descendant of this cell, and they are now, let's say, 20% of the cancer. Then there's treatment, and treatment could kill many cells, but maybe some of them happen to harbor a mutation that makes them resistant to the cancer, and then the clone continues to grow, and eventually there's a recurrence, and which continues to evolve, and maybe additional drivers are accumulated during this recurrent stage, and then a different treatment is given, and then again another resistance could occur, and this is kind of the life history of a cancer, at least ones that are not cured. These mutations are caused by different mutational processes. There are natural mutational processes that occur in every cell in the body, like these CpG2T methylated cytosines in CpGs that transform to T, and this occurs throughout life. And there could be other signatures that are caused by external kind of carcinogens, like cigarette smoke, and those could have impact and generate their own mutations with their own signature. And there could be other types of processes that, for example, one of the driver events could be losing some DNA repair. And from that point on, the cells have more mutations because they are less repairing mutations or damage that occurs during cell division. So just to summarize, drivers can be genetic or epigenetic, anything that goes from mother cell to daughter cells. They could be in the coding regions, could be non-coding regions. They're generated by different mutational processes, and they together kind of aspire to achieve the cancer hallmark, like evading immune response or uncontrolled growth, etc. They could support becoming resistant to cancers. They deactivate or activate different molecular programs. Cancer is heterogeneous, as you can see, and some of the mutations could expose germline risk allele. For example, the famous BRCA 1 or 2, a person could have one good copy and one bad copy of the gene, And if they lose during life the good copy, then the cells are left only with a bad copy and therefore have less of repair. So cancer is a dynamic and heterogeneous system, which is a kind of all the ingredients that you need for Darwinian evolution within the body. So why are we interested in all this cancer and drivers and the evolution of cancer? Is because of targeted therapies. He is kind of a poster child example of a 38-year-old man with metastatic melanoma that happened to have a BRAF V600E mutation. And this was at the time where vemurafenib was still kind of experimental. This patient got vemurafenib after a few weeks. There's no sign for the cancer. The sad part is that few weeks later, the cancer became resistant and it came back. But this is kind of a typical trend now with moving from more anatomy-based treatment like we used to do in the past to more genetic or molecular-based treatment where cancers are being treated with these targeted therapies that are addressing those particular proteins that are being altered or kind of essential for the cancer cells. And there's a growing arsenal of these targeted therapies. I think for cancer around the 85 or something like that now. And for example, you know, recently there was FDA recently approved the FGFR inhibitor for bladder cancer. So in order to understand the cancer genome, there's two major tasks. One I call characterization, which is to really understand an individual patient, what happened from the normal cells to the primary tumor, to the metastasis. So comparing their germline DNA to the somatic changes in the tumor and the metastasis. And then the interpretation task is to taking all these characterization data across a cohort of patients and then ask what are the genes or the parts of the genome or the pathways that are altered more than you'd expect by chance to identify what are those drivers compared to passengers, to identify subtypes of the disease, to associate with clinical parameters. In terms of the statistics or statistical power to in the characterization part, the power comes from, for example, depth of sequencing and how many samples you have for that patient. This tells you how accurate you could characterize what happened to the cancer from the normal to the cancer cell. How, if you're doing whole genomes versus whole exome, all of this will give you power to detect these events. In terms of the interpretation, the statistical power comes from the number of patients. The more patients you have more power to detect these drivers or subtypes and associate with clinical parameters. So all of this field was transformed by this kind of graph that you've probably seen many times, which is the drastic exponential decrease in cost of sequencing. Going back from 2001 with $100 million per genome sequencing to $1,000 today. And that is equivalent for a Tesla costing like $35,000 roughly to costing 35 cents. So this is a huge drop in cost that enables generating a large amount of exomes and whole genomes on cancer patients, which gives us both the ability to characterize their genomes and to interpret and identify the drivers. Addition, technologies like this capture technology that enables capturing parts of the genome, for example, the exomes, enables even a cheaper sequencing of exomes and then therefore doing more of them. Since the cost of genomes is dropping so dramatically, at some point it might not make sense to do the exomes anymore, we'll just do the entire genomes. So historically, since 2006, started the TCGA, which is the national project to characterize cancer genomes, and then extended in 2009 and essentially ended in 2016 with a paper still published later from the consortium. And this is the Cancer Genome Atlas with the aim of studying 20 to 25 tumor types, eventually studied 33 tumor types with some smaller cohorts with rare tumor types. every one of these large tumor types studied 500 tumor normal pairs with the whole exome sequencing to all of them. 10% had whole genome sequencing. Now there's more whole genome sequencing being generated. 20% had low-pass whole genome sequencing, all of them in the RNA-seq, both from mRNA and microRNA, SNP arrays for copy number and germline kind of SNPs, methylation arrays, and the proteomics done by reverse phase protein arrays. The International Cancer Genome Consortium is an umbrella organization for similar projects around the world. And the goal of the ICGC is to study 50 tumor types and the subtypes. Earlier this year, there was a many papers published out of a collaboration between TCGA and the ICGC to study whole genomes called the pan-cancer analysis of whole genomes. The primary goal of these projects is to basically generate a comprehensive catalog of all the cancer genes and pathways and subtypes, so we will have potential targets to develop drugs. So I will stop here for a second.
We have questions? Okay.